It's time for another QA. This, I can't believe it, 2 days in a row. I actually have quite a few QAs to do. I'm trying to get caught up on these now. And so today I have here questions from David T, who's one of our subscribers. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 pages of questions that I'm going to try to answer some of these questions I don't think I have a really good answer for, and I'll explain, okay? So as soon as I come back, we'll get started.
Hey!
Roger.
Oh, rocket cheek.
Roger.
Hello there.
So, I had to close my doors and my windows and turn my air conditioner on because we're getting huge waves today. We've actually been getting them all week. Here's a little video clip I did this morning with my phone, and you can see the waves that are way out there. Normally, on a normal day, we see one or two small waves that are close to shore. Here, as you can see from the clip here, the waves are, there's like one right after another, and they go way out there, okay? And so, and it's generating a lot of noise, believe it or not, so I had to close the place up to do this video. See how I take care of you folks? I'm doing all this just for you, so you won't be distracted by this background noise. I try to do the best I can. So, I got questions from David, and here we go. Greetings. I hope that you had a wonderful new year. Wife has come down with a severe cold. Thank you. I haven't gotten it. And thank God I haven't gotten it. Thank you. I hadn't gotten it. Okay. I don't know about you, but it seems that I can think of lots and lots of questions I would like answered. But as soon as I sit down to the keyboard, I forget most of them. LOL. Okay. Here's what's on my mind currently, but I'm sure I'll send you more questions before long. I know from your videos, yes, I had time and watched a few more, love them, that you have some professional contacts you can ask. Okay, number one question from David. Is it legal to carry a pocket knife in Ecuador? So, I carry a pocket knife. I mean, I've got a pocket knife, if I can find it here, that... Where in the hell is my pocket knife? It's always right here. Oh, here it is. I got this little... So it's I've had this knife for about 30 years. It's a Kershaw, you know, single blade. You know, it's nice. I bought this in Austin, Texas. And I left Austin, Texas in 1996. I think I bought this knife in like 1984 or something like that. It's got that wood that they make pipes out of. But anyway, back to your question, you can carry a machete around here. I thought, well, and I'll go ahead and skip to your next question too, because you also asked about carrying pepper spray. I contacted Maite Duran, my attorney friend that owns Gringo Visas, and I asked her this question, is it legal to carry pocket knives and pepper spray here? And her response was, they are not prohibited. That's all she said. I carry pepper spray. I carry this can of pepper spray with me just about everywhere I go. Okay, I don't carry a knife with me all the time, but I carry this with me everywhere I go. This came from the Miami Police Department. One of my friends that moved here brought this for me, and this is like the official their weapon of choice for pepper spray. It's supposed to be very, very effective. But anyway, that's what I carry. I carry it in my pocket. I don't, sometimes going down the street, I have it in my hand, but I keep it like kind of tucked in my hand like that. And if I'm not actually carrying it in my hand, it's in my pocket. If I see a cop coming, I just kind of tuck it away. I'm not going to find out, you know. I don't want to find out, because regardless of whether it's legal or not, it's going to be up to whatever the cop wants to do with you. if they stop you and they see it. They may use it as an opportunity to get a couple bucks out of you, and they may not. So, to answer your question, simply put, it's not prohibited. So, I say, if you want to carry a pocket knife and you want to carry pepper spray, if you can find it, by all means, carry it. Having a, question number three, I just answered one and two together, okay? It's funny too, your number two question, David, you said, is it legal acceptable to carry pepper spray? Hearing multiple reports of taxi cab robberies where they drive a gringo to a secluded location and then robbers hopping in the taxi really have concerned me. I've never heard of that happening here. That sounds like something that might could happen in Guayaquil, in South Guayaquil maybe. But I've not heard of that happening here in Manta. I don't know. Maybe if you get on the wrong side of town, you know, I can't imagine a taxi driver risking his license to lose what his livelihood to engage in an activity like that, cooperating with robbers and to rob gringos. I've not heard of that happening here. I just wondered if having a small bottle of pepper spray in my pocket would be beneficial. What are your thoughts on this? This thing here is can do a lot of harm. You know, I hope I never have to use it because it's windy here. You have to get yourself upwind from this when you spray it, because you certainly don't want it spraying back on you. As I reported in one of my earlier videos about me trying to spray a road rager in Arizona through an opening in my window, and I hit the top of the door jamb with the spray, and half of it came right back in on me. And the guy just laughed his ass off as he went away at me spraying myself with pepper spray. So I hope that helps you there. Question number three, having a hiatal hernia, GERD, acid reflux, how many more names can they give it? I take a prescription known as Protonix. I'm prescribed two a day, although I can only take one most days. And is this medication or medicine available there? And if so, what is the cost for 60 tablets? If it's not available, what is available there to control a heartburn? Thank you. So here's what I did. Folks, I'm going to tell you what I do. When I get questions like this about medication, I always look on Fibeca.com to see if they have it, because they have a search engine that you can use to find your medication. So I did a little video on my search about how to find information about a drug like this, okay? And here it is, okay?
Here is the website, Fibeca.com. It's the website, or Fibeca is the pharmacy that I use here. They're all over the place. They're all over Ecuador. So in your case, you're looking for Protonix, P-R-O-T-O-N-I-X. All right? And, of course, this is the results. Protolift, 40 milligram. But do you know if that's the right thing or not? We don't know that. So what I do is I go to this website here called Pill and Trip. Okay, and if you go to their homepage, you state where you're from, USA, okay, and the medication we're looking for is Protonix. And look at the choices that you have here. You have Protonix 4, Protonix Pantoprazole, whatever. They got some duplication here. And then they got extended, delayed release. So I don't know which of these will work, okay, but let's just say Protonix 4, where to find, scroll down here and we'll select Ecuador and go find pills. And here's alternative to Protonix 4 in Ecuador. The best equivalent in Ecuador is called Branzole, whatever. Okay, analog has exactly the same ingredients, pharmacological group, treatment option. Attention, read this. According to our data, analog has a 100% match, but we strongly recommend you consult with doctor before taking the analog. You can buy Branzol alternative to Protonix 4 in pharmacies in Ecuador. See, it says right there. Okay? So, that's what I found out about that.
So, I hope that helps. I you know, that's just what I do. If I happen to think about it when I'm in the mall, I might go into Fibeca or one of the other pharmacies and just ask them if they carry it, how much does it cost. But I try to do that. If I see that they're not busy, I'll do that. But if they got customers they're waiting on, I don't waste their time with it, because a lot of this information you can get online. Okay? Question number 4. I wear contacts and use the Airoptix brand. Are these available there? I have absolutely no clue. I've not talked to any eye doctors here. I don't know anybody that's had eye work done here. Well, I do know somebody that had eye surgery done here, but I don't know anybody here that wears contacts. So I can't help you with that one, David. I would just, I would wait until you get here and find out. You know, if they don't carry it here, I'm sure they will have something that's equivalent to it. I mean, we're not that much of a third world country here.
Right.
They have lots of eye doctors here, and I'm sure that if they don't have this particular brand, I'm sure they've got something that's equivalent to it, if not better. Question number 5. You mentioned using Schwab for U.S. banking. I don't have any funds to invest right now, and investments was all I could find on a quick search of their website. What website did you go to? If you go to Schwab.com, you can see all the stuff that they have to offer. Can you give a little detail from your experience on how to open a Charles Schwab account and checking account? I went to Schwab.com.
Okay, here's what I did. I just went to Schwab.com. Let's see. S-C-H-W-A-B.com. Okay, and right here on the right-hand side, right here, open an account. If you look at their accounts and products, here's another opportunity right here, brokerage and trading. Look at there, open an account. All right, over here, right here, you can open a checking account. So it's as simple as that. That's all I did.
That's all there is to it. It's go online. You can walk into a Schwab office. They have branches all over the United States. You can just walk into a branch and tell them, you know, with your ID and money, I guess, a deposit, and you can open an account. But I never once went into a branch, with the exception of the time that I had to deposit my check that I got from the closing company when I sold my condo. So, hope that helps. Number 6. Do you have any additional thoughts on opening a bank account that could be used there, here in Ecuador, and worldwide? I'm retiring this year, and we're selling the house and using a different state for permanent resident address, so our local credit union will be closed. I need a routing number and account number to use on my retirement paperwork. What has been your experience in retiring and getting your funds properly routed where you can access them? I had a local credit union account too, and I closed it because number one, they wouldn't reimburse my ATM fees in a foreign country like Schwab does. And number two, I just decided to go with a bigger, you know, internationally known bank. I moved all my investment stuff from TD Ameritrade, and I had some at Fidelity, and I moved those over to Schwab, put everything at Schwab. Here, I have no trouble getting money. There is no trouble getting money here. The ATM's everywhere. And if you open up a local bank account here, like at JEP, okay, you can transfer money, like I've said in many videos, you can just transfer, you can do a domestic wire transfer from Schwab to Banco Pichincha in Miami, in which JEP has an account, and then JEP will do an international transfer of your money from the Banco Pichincha bank account to your JEP account here in Ecuador. It takes about 2 days. I had to pay $25 to Charles Schwab, and that was it. Simple as that. 2 days later, I had my money in my local bank account. And then, of course, in the local bank accounts here, you can get Visa and MasterCard debit cards and credit cards, and you can use them internationally. Simple as that. Number seven, speaking of address, can you give any personal recommendations on getting, maintaining an address in the USA? I've heard of virtual mailboxes, but have no idea how that works. Okay, so I did a little cursory search on Facebook, Mark Badbury's Facebook page here, and asked if anybody had any experience with virtual mailboxes, and I got flooded with responses. So there's tons of them. There's a bunch of them, and I got all kinds of reports, good and bad, from people about virtual mailboxes. My best recommendation to you is go online and find one and start asking questions. Look at the reviews, check the Better Business Bureau, and see what you can find out about. Spend some time and do some research. I would do it for you, but I don't have the time to research virtual mailboxes. I don't use one. I have an address in Phoenix that belongs to some friends of mine that I'm very close to, and that's my address for the IRS and the Social Security, my bank, and everybody. So, I personally don't see a need for a virtual mailbox, but it's just me, okay? Everybody's situation is different, and some people need that mailbox where you can still get mail. They can open it for you, scan it, email it to you, forward it to you, do all that good stuff. The mail that I get in my mailbox today and for the last 10 years has been nothing but junk. So I get an email notice every day from mail that's addressed to me, that's been forwarded to my other address, and it's always just junk. So that's all I can say about that. Number eight, the bitter truth, a.k.a. the good, the bad, and the ugly, sure. I understand that you must be careful when you criticize, but I would greatly appreciate it if you would do a video of the bitter truth. I just watched your video and you asked. It's actually not the bitter truth, it's called the brutal truth. I did a video, the brutal truth about living in Ecuador, the good, the bad, and the ugly. The brutal truth is the ugly, the bad. Okay, I had 21 items, I believe, 20 or 21 items in that video that I talked about. I'm not going to post that video on this channel. I've been warned by several people that it wouldn't be a good idea to do it. I have it posted on my personal YouTube video, and if you want to see it, send me an email, and I'll send you a link to it, and you can go and watch it. So, keep in mind, it's just me telling how I feel, and you got to look at it with an open mind. You definitely want to keep an open mind when you look at it, because what might be bad to me may not be bad to you. Noise to me may not be noise to you. There are people here that don't hear noise, like I do. So, if you want to see it, send me an email. Here's my email address right here. And it's in the description. And send it to me and I'll send you the link. David continued to say, one thing I greatly appreciate about your videos is your honesty in that you don't sugarcoat the negative. A rainbow and unicorn portrayal doesn't do anyone any favors. The other couple, talking about another YouTube couple, does have a lot of good information, but they either don't tell or they downplay the negatives. As the old adage goes, to be forewarned is to be forearmed. And I, for one, want a good idea of what I'm getting into. And as you say, if they don't like your video, bite me. That's what I say. That's my answer to that question. If you want to see the video, folks, send me an email and I'll give you a link and you can go and watch it. Number nine, I'm not naive, but also refuse to walk around in fear. No place on earth is without crime. We're humans and there are both good and bad. Ecuador has its share of crime, but from everything I've read and heard, is still much safer than many places in the U.S., and I agree with that 100%. I do know that situational awareness is numero uno in remaking safe. What other recommendations do you have for a couple close to your age to remain safe there? In the U.S., the security team of Mr. Smith and Mr. Wesson are available to protect you, but I know they can't travel to Ecuador. You know, listen to what everybody tells you, folks. When you come here, and crime here is petty crime. And then there's the major crime that goes on between the cartels and the gangs. I've not seen any bandidos walking down the street with the bullets hanging off their chest and big rifles and, you know, walking around looking for somebody to shoot. I've not seen that. But petty crime is, I've been a victim of petty crime twice since I've been here. And it's my fault, both times. It was my fault. I didn't listen to my own advice. Keep your head on a swivel. Stay out of unsafe neighborhoods. Don't carry flashy jewelry around with you. Don't wear fancy, nice clothes. Ladies, take the necklaces and the bracelets off and leave them at home when you're out about and traveling, okay? You can wear all that stuff when you go to social gatherings and getting together with all of your expat friends, okay? But, you know, when going to the mall or going shopping down in the Tarquee, you don't want to have all that stuff with you, okay? Use common sense. Like I said in one of my videos, I've done multiple videos about safety here. If you find yourself in a neighborhood and you're by yourself, you're in a bad place, okay? You need to get out of there. That's it. Common sense is everything. It's all about common sense. Number 10, as much as I'd love to watch all your videos, I don't have time. Plus, I am not a computer guru, and YouTube doesn't make it easy to find all of anyone's videos. Wish I could find them all chronologically and start from the beginning. Can you tell us how to do that? Is there a way to locate them chronologically? Yes, there is. Watch this video, okay?
Okay, so here's my channel. This is the Don Shader Ecuador channel. If you're a subscriber and you actually go to my channel, this is what you see, okay? And if you see, they have these different categories here. Home, videos, shorts. I've done a few shorts. Playlists, so forth. These are my playlists. Community, this is where I go to do shorts that I can do from my phone. Other channels that I belong, I don't have any. And then, of course, there's the About Me page, okay? So if you go to videos, like right here, you can see every single one of my videos. And they're in order. They're in order by date. There's 220 videos, I believe. This one here will make 221. But, you know, you can go through here. I don't recommend, some data is redundant, you know. I don't say go through here and watch all my videos. That's, you would be probably thoroughly bored and suicidal by the time you got a third of the way through. Especially the early videos, that's like these here that you see here. This is the very first video right here. My migration to retirement in Ecuador. It's been viewed 3,300 times. I can't believe that. But I remember when I came here, it had been viewed like 10 times, and all 10 of those were me. So that's it. That's how you...
Okay. That's all there is to it. You go to my channel, get on a computer, a laptop or a desktop, and go to my channel, select videos. They're all in order. There's 220 plus one, 221 videos, I believe, that are posted. The very first ones, the first four or five, I wouldn't waste my time with because they're really pretty bad. Number 11, our initial trip will be exploratory, good thinking. And then we're going to check out some places such as Portugal before deciding where to relocate permanently. Right now, Ecuador is number one on our list, though. Any additional thoughts for a couple permanently moving there? Any things that, looking back, you wish you'd done differently? Of course, I mean, what he says, other than putting your stuff in storage for a year before moving it there. Yes, I do pay attention to what you had to say. I mean, you know, the best preparation for getting here is to watch my videos and watch a million JP's videos and watch GM Ace and watch the Yarbrough. Well, the Yarbroughs are world travelers. You know, there are lots of YouTube videos about living in Ecuador, and there's good and there's bad ones. Look at Ecuador Raw and Real. I like his videos because he shows you the streets of Manta. He does that a lot. Ecuador Raw and Real. Check him out. That's my buddy, Carmen. So, you said any additional thoughts for a couple of permanent, any things, looking back, you wish you'd done differently? I wish I'd kept my condo for a little bit longer and then sold it instead of selling it right away, because I would have made probably another $100,000 on it. I wish I had kept my car in storage. I wish I'd kept a bunch of my stuff in storage for a year. That's really one of the biggest things that when I look back, I wish I'd done differently. I sold everything, got rid of everything, and just packed it up and went. So that's really about all I can say about that. Number 12, hobbies. I'll build these 1/25 scale plastic model cars as a hobby and wish to continue in retirement. Rainy days, I don't want to just sit looking out the window. The thing is, I have many of these kits, mostly made by Revel, AMT, MPC, Polar Lights, and a few others. You can look by the seat. Can you talk with some of your professionals about how I can bring these kits with me? Brutal truth here, I wouldn't bring them. Let me tell you what I think will happen. If you come with a boatload of these models, you're gonna throw up a big old red flag in customs, and you're gonna pay taxes on that stuff big time, because they're gonna think you're here to sell it. And how are you gonna prove you're not? So I would be really cautious about that. Even if you put it all in a container, you know, everything goes through customs. But then again, there's another side of the story that you can think about. I came here with two large suitcases, two small suitcases, and two backpacks, and not a single one of them got opened up at customs. Came right on through, no questions asked, no looking at anything. But if you come in with a bunch of stuff like that, they only allow you to bring like two laptops, two computers, two cameras, you know. If they see more than two seems to be the magic number, and you're gonna have to deal with customs. So you said also your wife sews quilts and has as much fabric as I do models. Some reason we knew retirement would be fixed income plus a very high quality Husqvarna sewing machine. You won't have trouble getting a sewing machine in here. But you know, all the cloth and stuff, you're gonna throw up a big old flag at customs, and you're probably gonna have to pay some pretty heavy import fees to get that stuff in here, if they even allow you to bring it. I would definitely talk to somebody like Paul Wilches, who does shipping, you know. Talk to an immigration lawyer and see what they have to say about it before you pack up all this stuff and start bringing it. I was worried about bringing photography gear and having some of, you know, I have multiple lenses, but would I be able to explain to them that they're all different focal lengths and, you know, they're not duplicates and I'm not bringing anything here to sell? So that's a good question, and that's my best answer. If you want to talk about it more, David, send me an email with your phone number and I'll give you a call. We do canning, vegetables, homemade soup, jellies. This is question number 15. Number 14. Another hobby question. I homebrew 5-gallon batches, lots of bottles and equipment. You can get all that stuff here. Get rid of all that stuff. Why pay all the shipping costs to get all that stuff here? Don't waste your time with that, David. Number 15, hobby. We do canning, vegetables, homemade soup, jellies, etc. Bring some of that to my place. Especially homemade soup. So we have probably a couple hundred mason canning jars in half pint and quart sizes, as well as heavy duty pressure canner. Do you have any ideas, suggestions on getting all this in Ecuador if we do decide to make it home? Yeah, don't bring that stuff with you. You can buy all that here. don't spend all that money, you know, shipping all this stuff. The candy, the stuff that you've already got canned and stuff, take it to a food bank. Give it away, you know, before you leave here. Keep your costs simple. Come back, come here and start with all new stuff. You can buy this stuff really cheap here. No telling what you can get all these jars for. I'm sure it's pennies on the dollar. So don't bring your clothes and your shoes and a hat and computer and camera, laptop, so you can watch my videos and be happy. 16, last but not least, I enjoy gardening and have some favorite varieties of tomatoes and hot peppers that I like to grow. What are the legalities of getting vegetable seeds in Ecuador? I realize that I'd probably have to get new unopened seed packs to bring, and I also realize that the varieties I want might not even grow there, but I'd still like to try. This is another question I posted on Facebook group page, and some folks said it's illegal to bring in seed. That's what I know. Maybe you can get away with some, but you know, if you have a bunch of seeds there, again, why pay to ship all that stuff that you can get here? You can bring unopened packets, and some said they just stuff some seed packets into their luggage. In the first place, you're going to have to find a place to grow. I mean, if you're going to be in Manta, you're not going to have a yard. This is a concrete jungle here. You know, but if you get on the outskirts, maybe you can have a garden, you know. But as far as bringing seeds and stuff like that, me personally, I wouldn't waste my time with it. You can get all that here. Thank you so much for taking the time to read my email and give your insights you have into all of this. I know you don't give advice, that's right, but you do have some thoughts and insights you can share since you've been there a while. Have a blessed day. So, I had one more email from David with some questions on it, and then we'll be done. Hola, my friend. I told you I'd have more questions. It seems at my age I should write them all down so I remember, but when I go to write them, I forget. By the way, folks, look, go to the local office supply store and get you a couple of these little books, you know, and make notes, all right? Don't just put it on your phone. Make notes. Like valuable login information and stuff like that. You know, I filled one of these up with notes on coming here. So, you know, keep notes. Or you can use Google Keep. You can do notes online through Google. All right, here's this question. It's got five questions here. Do you suggest having more than one U.S. bank account before leaving the U.S.? If something happened to one account or debit card, you'd have a backup with a question mark. Well, that's up to you. Me personally, I don't. I just have the one bank. If I lost a debit card or a credit card, I would just call them up and have them send me a new one via DHL. You know, and it would cost me $100 or more, but, you know, that's over the long run, that's probably cheaper than maintaining another bank account unless you just have so much money that you need another place to put your money. I don't think it would be necessary. Personally, I don't think it would be necessary. Number two, what credit card do you recommend that can be used abroad and doesn't charge fees for use out of the U.S.? I don't know of a credit card that doesn't charge international fees. That's how they make money, folks. Remember, these big banks and, you know, there's these large entities like that, they make big bucks off of every little service they can think of to charge you. And you're going to pay international fees. But listen, I've been here 19 months, going on 20 months, and I haven't used a credit card here yet. So, and if I do, it'll be online to Amazon or something like that in the U.S. Number three, health insurance. Do you have Ecuador-only insurance, or is yours good wherever you travel? I have Ecuador health insurance. It costs me $59 a month. It covers me for $15,000 a year here in Ecuador. If you wrote, what options have you found or are aware of? If you did return to the U.S., what would you do for insurance since Medicare penalizes you big time for not signing up initially? Well, how do you sign up for Medicare, David? As soon as you start drawing Social Security, you get Medicare. It's part of your Social Security package. All right? You sign up for Part B, which I dropped and saved myself $170 a month. I don't plan to go back to the U.S. and, you know, I don't have to worry about them penalizing me for re-signing up for Plan B. Besides, I'm a veteran. I can get my Plan B services from the VA. So I don't need it. I know people that still pay for Part B, and they're just giving their money away. But, you know, those are the people that will probably go back. So, Medicare penalizes you. They only penalize you when you re-sign for Part B. What another way for the big insurance carriers to line their pockets with profits, especially from seniors. That's what pisses me off. You know, they shouldn't be doing that to us. They shouldn't be penalizing us because we don't pay $170 a month for something that we can't use. I can't use Medicare Part. I can't use Medicare here at all. So why pay for it? If I thought for sure I was going back to the U.S., which I may do and I may not, you know, I'll go to the VA and get my stuff. Number four, I watched your video with your realtor friend about renting in Manta. I'm sure she gets paid commissions, so wouldn't really be keen on looking for rentals or someone wanting 2 months. I also know that you had a bad experience with Airbnb there. We plan to stay only 2 months, two in each, Manta, Cuenca, and Loja, on our initial Ecuador trip. Can you recommend a good, reasonably priced rental for his apartment Airbnb for 2 months this year? No, I'm not a realtor. I can't recommend that at all. You need to talk to a rental agent like Stella Coulter. Okay? I'm thinking $400, $600 range. Yeah, sorry. I can't recommend any place to live. Other than, you know, if you're just going to be here for a short term like that, in Cuenca, I'd go to the Grand Columbia Suites if you can get in, you know. I'll put a link in the description to them, Grand Columbia Suites. They're awesome in Cuenca. They're close to the Parque Calderon, the Blue Domes, and close to shopping and everything. Beautiful place. I was in there when I was there last year just to visit. And, yeah, you're right. I mean, the rental agents get paid commissions. And sometimes these rental agents don't work with short-term rentals. I honestly have to say, I mean, you can talk to Stella because she does have some contacts with people that have that own apartments here, and that they rent them out to people for short term when they're not here. I have a friend that lives across the street from me in Santorini, has a beautiful large apartment right on the water, and they're only here a month or so a year, and that's it. You know, maybe 2 months, I don't really remember, but they rent their place out to people, you know, and you can talk to Stella about places like that, okay? Number five, the last question, and then we'll be done. Thoughts on offshore bank accounts to put some money into for safekeeping? As in, if the U.S. economy tanked, we'd still have some money available to us. I've heard of this, but no knowledge of where or how it works. I don't have any knowledge of any offshore banks. I don't recommend it. I don't have that much money. And most of the people that I know around here don't have so much money that they need offshore bank accounts to hide money from the U.S. in case it tanks. That's it, David. I'm done with you, man. And I hope that I get a chance to meet you when you come here, as with Michael from the video I did yesterday. Have a great day. If you like this channel, please subscribe. If you like this video, smash that thumbs up button. And you can also hit the subscribe or the bell. I keep forgetting about that. You hit ring that bell. And that way you can get notified when I post a new video. And if you don't like this video, bite me. So until the next time, ciao, ciao.